This passion fruit one contains 3 grams of blue goba penis envy. And look how beautiful it is. They use legitimate gold in making this. This is wild. That was one of the strongest, if not the strongest mushroom trip I've ever had in my life. Welcome back to Psyched Substance. In today's episode, we are going to be doing something that I have never done before. We are going to be exploring the world, as in eating mushroom-infused chocolates. Now, before we get started, I have to make it absolutely clear that I do not recommend that anybody watching tries anything. We are simply filming this video for the sake of documentary purposes and to see what happens when someone consumes mushroom chocolate. These products are becoming a lot more common these days, meaning it's time that I do a safety video on it to show you guys how to do it properly if you're going to do it. Again, I don't recommend anybody does it, but through this video, hopefully you learn how to do it properly, how to do it safely, and what to do in case something, horrible happens, like a potential bad trip.
According to YouTube guidelines shown here, videos which intend to educate are documentary by nature and do not glorify the use of drugs. Those abide by the community safety guidelines and are eligible for monetization. The following video does not glorify the use of drugs. Instead, attempts to be non-biased while delivering vital life-saving information disguised as entertainment.
Of course, before we dive into consuming of the delicious chocolate bar, I need to let you guys know that today's video is sponsored by Surfshark. They have been awesome and they've continued to sponsor our content. For those of you who don't know, Surfshark is a VPN. And what that does is allows you to surf the internet protected. Meaning if you're watching videos like this that are still unfortunately very taboo, you enable your VPN. You can change your IP location so it looks like you're from a different country, and your internet provider no longer is privileged access to seeing the sites that you visit. It allows you to truly surf anonymously. It also, as a bonus, allows you to visit websites like Disney Plus and change your country. Apparently in the States, it's all just kids stuff, whereas if you changed your country to Canada, you get Star Entertainment on Disney Plus, and you get a whole slew of adult shows. If you use the code PSYCHED, you are going to receive 83% off Surfshark VPN. That is a massive, massive discount. It's currently the best price for a VPN on the market, and you're also going to get 3 extra months. Surfshark have been beyond amazing to me by, again, continuing to sponsor these videos, which allows me to hopefully hire that editor soon. I'm sure you guys are tired of me talking about that. So I would greatly appreciate if all you guys went and checked out Surfshark. Follow the link in the video description. Use code PSYCHED. Get that 83% off. Anyway, now that we got that sponsorship ad out of the way, let's jump into the actual experience. Now, before we get started, I'm going to explain to you guys the materials that you need in order to have the most safe experience possible. Of course, again, not to sound like a broken record, well, the best form of harm reduction is quite actually abstinence, meaning just don't take the damn compound, which is what I am recommending. But again, if you are going to do so anyway, I'm going to explain and demonstrate how to do so in a safe way so you don't hurt yourself. Now, this is not going to be an exhaustive list. We're going to cover the essentials. The first thing you're going to need is a proper good set and setting. How you feel, where you are in your life, your current mental space, what your thoughts are like, and the setting being exactly what it sounds like, where you are having your experience. A lot of people think that mushrooms are going to be fantastic when eaten in nature, which I agree, but what a lot of people don't realize is that's probably not an area that you want to be in until you have some experience under your belt. The best place to start is in the comfort of your own home. You want to be able to control as many aspects of the experience as possible, which is ironic to say considering the very act of taking the psychedelic is kind of surrendering control. And you want to be with someone that you trust and ideally love, someone you care about. You want to be with someone who you can actually be your naked self with without having to put on a facade. So now, assuming you've got set and setting under control, the next thing you want to do is make sure that you got some headphones and a playlist ready, not just for enjoyment, but you want to have a relaxing playlist already picked out in case the experience takes some scary turns. And these experiences, they're not all scary usually, and they're not all positive. It takes you on a journey, which is why for the parts of the journey that could be a little challenging, it's good to have music that can help calm you down and, you know, reconnect you with your breath. Next, shameless plug, you're going to want to have a soft trip blanket. You don't really need a blanket. You just need to have very comfortable, warm clothes on. More often than not, it's going to result in you feeling cold rather than warm, and everybody likes to be cozy when they're tripping. This is actually our new pink and black, I'm gonna open it for you guys, trip blankets that we have finally gotten in stock. Ever since you guys saw them in the video I did with Lauren, you guys have been asking for it. And you know what? It's not that ugly. I like the design. It's nice to have something that's black. Obviously, you don't need my trip blanket to have a positive experience, but you want some cozy clothes and some cozy blankets nearby so that, you know, you can snuggle up. Anyway, you can pick up one of these trip blankets by visiting the link to psychsubstance.shop. And I do have to point out that I think we only have 150 of these. Those 150 are gonna sell out really fast. So if you wanna pick one of these up, you do have to head on over to psychsubstance.shop immediately and place your order. We might just, you know, do these 150 and then move on. Next, this is a controversial item, but I believe you want to have an escape rope, like you're playing Pokemon and you went into that dungeon. And for that, you're gonna use a benzodiazepine. Now, there are other chemical compounds that can be used as trip killers. Antipsychotic medication works too, but benzos are really the most easily accessible by most people. Now, what I have here is alprazolam, and you can really use any of them. You can use clonazepam, lorazepam. There's a whole slew of benzodiazepines that can be administered as trip killers. What you would do is say you're experiencing symptoms of a bad trip, your thoughts start to race, you get really paranoid. Say you try meditating for a bit, you try focusing on your breath and nothing works, you're just getting more and more panicky. You would take the lowest effective dose, you would chew it, so you want to dissolve it under your tongue so it comes on as fast as possible. If it's something like alprazolam, within 10-15 minutes, you're going to calm down. In fact, some people experience an instant calm down. Often I find just knowing that you have something like this on hand is enough to thwart bad trips. It's better to be safe than sorry. There's a whole group of people who say that it's best to ride out the trips, and there's no such thing as a bad trip, and the bad experiences teach you the most. And while that is 100% accurate, there are instances where people have a bad mushroom or acid trip and they go and fucking kill themselves. So in that instance, wouldn't it have been better to just kill the trip? And not everyone's ready for those kinds of experiences. So you really want to be cautious. And that's the next point, is always start with the lowest effective dose. And when it comes to psilocybin mushrooms, a good first-timer experience would be 1 to 2 grams. I know a lot of you guys, that sounds like an abysmal amount, like that's nothing, but if you've never tripped before, you really want to start, I think, by getting your feet wet. At least with 1 to 2 grams, you're kind of like 1 foot in, 1 foot out, and if it's not for you, you're going to know really soon. What's really important is just don't push things too far. For a first experience, I would not go above 4 grams. Like, 4 grams is going to be, yeah, the upper end of a first trip when it comes to mushrooms. For other compounds, well, we'll talk about that in videos that are based on other compounds. You just really want to practice safe use and go easy on yourself, because you can always take more, but you can never take less. Hey guys, I want to point out that if you watch the extended version, it's actually like a totally different episode. It even includes footage of me eating a whole other chocolate bar, not included in this one, meaning I eat more mushroom chocolate in the extended version. So if you want to watch the extended version and this has just come out, it's going to be released a little bit later, today or tomorrow. But if you're watching this after it's been out for a day or so, you can just follow the link in the video description to watch the extended version, which again is like a whole totally new different video. Cheers, guys. Let's move on to the next part of the video. This is the exciting part where we eat the chocolates. And I want to point out that, where I live, just because you can easily obtain this, there's so many different brands of chocolate that you can get. These big ass bars. And then I got this huge one. Look at how delicious this looks. Oh. Oh, it's actually tempting to sit here and eat one of these delicious bars. Like, it tastes like a legitimate, amazing chocolate bar. Like, it's dangerous, actually dangerous, because it's so good. You could just sit here, and before you know it, you've eaten the whole 3 gram bar when you wanted to microdose, and you're, before you know it, you're in a full trip. You can barely taste the mushrooms in these. I don't know how they did it. Freaking good, man. All right, now before we get started, I do want to point out that psilocybin isn't legal all across Canada. However, there are some places in Canada where you can buy this stuff, and the government is aware of it and they just don't care. It's kind of like what happened with cannabis, where in the beginning, before cannabis became legal, you could buy cannabis at certain places. The government knew about it, they didn't stop it, and then soon after that, cannabis became legal. Something very similar is happening with mushrooms. They know that people are selling them in the form of chocolate bars, they're not stopping it. The next course of action is likely it's going to be legal. I mean, this is what happens. The people dictate what compounds come next. And it's because people are showing such an interest in psilocybin these days, and the people are basically saying, look man, we know it's not dangerous. No one's ever died from eating too many mushrooms, not from overdose at least. Like, psychological reasons, sure, but no one's died from, like, you know, just eating too much and, you know, their heart stopping or anything like that. And the people are beginning to realize that there is a lot of medicinal benefits to these compounds when they're used safely and in the proper way. And then there's certain states where they've actually decriminalized or maybe even legalized psilocybin. Yeah, it's a pretty exciting time we're living in. A lot of people like to say how terrible these times are, but there's also progress happening. Stuff like this becoming readily available in many places, this is progress, because this kind of thing can heal so many people as long as they know how to do it safely, which is why I create these videos. So this passion fruit one contains 3 grams of blue goba penis envy. In case you guys don't know, it's about twice as potent as traditional psilocybin mushrooms. So this bar would be like 6, maybe even more grams worth. This would be a freaking ride. And look how beautiful it is. They use legitimate gold in making this. This is wild. This actually looks delicious. And as you can see, I've tried a few pieces for a microdose already of this one. Pretty good. It tastes awesome, but we're not going to be doing the blue goba penis envy trip today. That's super intense. We'll maybe do that one another time. So what we are going to do is we're going to do the 3 gram. I'm going to eat this entire bar. God damn my calorie intake. This entire bar of matcha cha-cha chocolate. And that's going to be 3 grams total of psilocybe cubensis. So yeah, let's get going. Huh, I like the little message in there. It says, keep growing. Okay, we will keep growing. Ooh, look at this. This looks tasty. These bars look amazing. Oh, yum. Look at this bar. They do a really good job, these guys. All right. It tastes like real chocolate. That was good. You know what I think I'll do? Screw that. We're gonna go for the penis envy too. Yeah, I got a good feeling about this. We can try some of each. So we're gonna do one line of this. Let's try the gold of the penis envy. We'll do one line of this one. Oh, that's way better. Oh, this passion fruit is delicious. You would never guess that there's mushrooms in this versus this one. Oh, so bad. So there we go. So we did one row of that, and then I'm gonna do a total of 3 rows of this one, which considering that's penis envy, is going to give us the equivalent of 3 grams. Wait, no, for the equivalent of 3 grams, we need one more piece. There we go, let's get this right. There we go. I know I'm making it more complicated. I could have just done this whole bar, but I wanted to mix it up a little bit. Why not? So let's do a mix of psilocybe cubensis and penis envy to show you guys just how crazy strong penis envy is. To be honest, that's probably the equivalent of a little bit more than 3 grams of cubes. But yeah, I just wanted to try the taste, which is really good. Imagine this is like all just some excuse so I can eat chocolate, because like I don't eat milk, right? And I try not to eat sugar, and I'm really strict with my diet. So wouldn't it be hilarious? It's like in the back of my head, I'm subconsciously rationalizing eating mushroom chocolate as like, I get to cheat on my diet and have some chocolate today. Oh, last bite, best bite, baby. Down the hatch. Oh shoot, I was wrong. So the blue goba has a average tryptamine content of 2.115, and the cubes average between 0.6 to 0.8. That's more than twice as potent. So I just had potentially the equivalent of like 3.5 grams. Oh boy. Now, something that I like to do before these experiences hit is, a quick meditation. When you focus on your breathing and you breathe rhythmically and slow, it relaxes the nervous system. Like, it has a true physiological effect on the body, which causes you to feel more relaxed and centered. So it's a great way to enter these experiences. So let's just bear with me while I do that. Oh, before I forget, you also want to have intention. How did I miss that? And I'm going to set an intention for this experience right now. I personally like using psychedelics as tools to help heal aspects of my life that, well, I'm struggling with, that need fixing. And right now, even though I'm doing the hormone therapy and all that stuff, I still want to be off the kratom. So I'm going to put that out into the universe. Don't mind me while I sound like a raging hippie for a moment. I am putting out the intention that this experience is going to shine a light on, you know, just why I am still on the kratom train, and it's going to show me how to move through it. Yeah, just experience life. Maybe even drug-free. Just being me. That would be ideal. And let's see if the mushrooms can give me what I asked for. Often you don't get the experience that you ask for. You get the experience that you need. Maybe that's what I need, maybe it's not, but at least I'm putting it out into the universe and let's see if it delivers. Wouldn't it be really crazy if after this experience I actually stopped drinking kratom? I went on the hormone therapy, I've done all these crazy things, and all I really need to do was eat some gosh darn mushroom chocolate. It's currently too early on to see if that'll actually happen, but let's throw it out there and let's see if it happens. I will tell you guys this, I will be completely honest in the outcome. If this trip has absolutely no effect whatsoever on me wanting to take kratom daily, I'll let you know. I'll tell you that my kratom intake didn't change, and I'm not going to try to force myself to lower the intake just to artificially impregnate this experience with the child of growth. Like, no, that baby can just go F off if he's not made from authentic, legitimate causes. We want him to be a natural birth, not forced. So what I'm going to do is let the dice land where it lands, and we'll read the numbers as they roll, and we'll see what we get. Yeah. I'm just going to see what happens. Anyway, if you're wondering why I'm talking so much, it's because I haven't decided if I'm going to just cut to the effects or if I'm going to make this video one of those where it's like I'm filming the whole come up. I might do two. You know what? That's a good idea. Let's do two. I'm starting to... The lights are starting to... slowly but surely get brighter. Oh, that's usually one of the first signs for me, is everything just starts looking really, really bright and then vivid. So let's do that meditation now. Oh boy. Look, judging by how fast everything is starting to look like DMT world, you know that was strong. Especially the initial feeling and visuals of mushrooms, I find remarkably similar to DMT. Sure, it's feeling too tight. Yeah. Yeah, I'm feeling cold. Definitely already feel cold. My eyes closed. This is exactly like a DMT trip. There's no difference. Even open, so similar. If you told me that I just smoked like 25, 30 milligrams of DMT, I would not argue. Entire body is warm and vibrating. And with eyes closed, I'm taking through spinning, morphing geometry of these like red black tunnels. Feels like I'm going through wormholes. No buzzing in my ears though. The next stage of this, like the intensity just gets to a point where I just like, this is anything like DMT, where I just need to close my eyes and pass out, and these cameras are gonna run out of juice soon. I'm gonna pause them and go lay down, but I'm just telling you, that's all I'm doing is laying down. This has gotten mega intense, mega fast. Like, the room is starting to morph into something else. All right, 7 hours later, I am completely back. I gotta say one thing. These chocolate bars are bullshit. That was like a flat out lie. That was no three to 3.5 grams. That felt closer to, I don't know, 5, 6, 7. That was at least 5 grams worth. I was straight blasted into hallucinatory states, which quickly transitioned into basically crossing over into DMT world with supreme intensity. That was one of the strongest mushroom experiences, if not the strongest mushroom trip I've ever had in my fucking life. The chocolates are a lie. Claiming 3 grams a bar. No. If it is, this is some potent shit. They are dosing people way higher. Keep in mind, I microdose mushrooms every morning, sometimes as much as 0.5 gram. So I have a tolerance from literally doing mushrooms every day, and it still hit me like a goddamn freight train. 7 hours later, and I'm only just now, like, pretty much back. That lasted a long time. For me, mushrooms, usually 3 to 4 hours are, like, done. That felt like the trip that would never end. Whew. I'm assuming you guys want to know what happened. Some of these experiences are, like, really hard to put into words, especially right after you've come down. I will say that there was a solid portion of it where I felt like, oh man, this one went all over. Like, it actually started off really positive and warm. Like, it went from that to like a kind of scary place, which I'm used to. These experiences, they always do that transition for me. And I just kind of faced the fear. I mean, I didn't take a trip killer. There was points where I was tempted though. Holy smokes, was I tempted. Yeah, it made me face what just felt like fear itself. I felt like I was being exorcised. Like, there was an exorcism going on, and it was subtracting this demon from me. At points, like, my personality is split into two parts. All I'm focusing on this entire time is my breath. I could barely move. Anytime I'd get up, just getting up, like lifting up to change my shirt, the energy of doing that made me feel like I was gonna almost vomit. The nausea is going to be increased with potency or dose, and considering there's no way that was just 3 grams, yeah, the nausea makes sense. So just keep in mind, I couldn't really move. I really just was focused on laying as still as possible, to be as least nauseous as possible. When the dose is that high, I spend a lot of time being in like this waking delirium type dream, where it's like you feel like your personality is split apart, like I said, into multiple facets, and they're not just one being anymore. And I think that can be very healing, because it can show you very blatantly and like literal terms the different aspects of yourself. There was another part of this experience when I was laying there just observing things, where I saw some people that came into my life recently that wanted to be friends, and I saw just how horribly unhealthy those people were. And it was almost like the mushrooms were looking out for me, and they were like, Adam, take a step back. You're not thinking straight here. These are not people you want to be friends with. Look at all of these red flags they've displayed to you that you just kind of passed, you know, let slide by, probably because you were in Kratom at the time and you weren't cognizant enough to realize that they were showcasing some personality traits that you do not want to be associated with. And I was like, oh, thank you. All right, I'm going to take a step back and not follow through there. It's fascinating that the mushroom can show you that. Very grateful that it showed me that. See, these experiences often feel like the mushroom is its own entity. I like how they put it in the Paul Stamets video, the Fantastic Fungi, where the woman's talking about, she asked the mushroom during the experience if she was at least gonna leave the at least as strong as she started, and the mushroom was like, why would I disrespect my own handiwork? I like to look at it like that. That makes it feel at least a little more forgiving and like it's got your back, like it's got this autonomy about it where it wants to, you know, it wants what's best for you. So yeah, I like to look at it like it's a guide, like it's a protector, and maybe just having that intent put forth is enough to influence the experience in a positive direction. Because on the flip side, I've looked at it as if it was like an evil thing, the experience felt more evil. So I feel like this is where intent is huge, and how we choose, what perspective we choose to view them from, greatly either inhibits the potential for growth that can come out of the experience or entices it. It's interesting making a video as like the effects are coming down and I'm almost fully cognizant, like I've got my rational mind and I'm able to articulate these thoughts in a way that if I were to say wait till tomorrow to film this, they wouldn't be as fresh. So I think this is the perfect time to be breaking down the experience I just had, you know, as much of it as I'm able to break down, because there are some parts that I'm still registering. But yeah, I wanted to explain a bit of the roller coaster aspect of like jumping between blissful states and terror. So for this experience, the beginning was very much so painted with bliss. It was awesome, very warm. So the first part of this experience was pretty much the same as if I smoked, probably 30, 40 milligrams of DMT. The only difference was the mushrooms lasted longer. That was overstaying its welcome. Like I kind of wanted it to stop, because then the blissful warmth faded. And the next stage I was in was this like weird in-between. I felt like really low and depressed, but I couldn't put my finger on why. Like there wasn't a singular overarching negative theme that was tugging me down. Like I felt low and I didn't know why. And I think this is when I was experiencing the personality breaking apart into a few different fractals of itself. It's weird how it was accompanied by a very depressed vibe. It reminded me almost of like the next day when you're coming down off MDMA and you feel empty and you have the feeling like you don't know why you're sad, but it feels like there's absolutely nothing to look forward to or to live for in the world, like that serotonin depletion, dopamine depletion vibe. That's what it felt like. I've never had that before. Not so close and so tied in with like the good feeling. So to transition from feeling good to just that miserable was fucking weird. I've been feeling very exhausted, and it's interesting. I'm starting to get my energy back now. Literally the past 7 hours I've been laying down, but it's like when I finally got up, I didn't feel like I'm rested. Like, you know what I mean? It's not like I've been asleep for 7 hours, because I haven't. It's been in this weird in-between state. It's like I'm mentally and physically exhausted. Getting sustenance from peanut butter, as if I haven't had enough fat sources today from that chocolate. God damn it. This is the worst kind of peanut butter. It's filled with hydrogenated oil. I usually eat organic peanut butter, but like when the craving strikes, baby. Anyway, so yeah, I don't know. I can't really define why I felt so low, but I felt really freaking low. And that was hard to witness. During that state, I almost reached for the trip killer. No word of a lie. Because while I was in that low state, the DMT-esque experience of breaking through to the other side started to reach its climax. So it's not like things calmed down and then I started feeling low. No. The intensity was still rising. As it was rising, my mood went from jolly to sad. So that sucked. And that lasted like a solid hour, which in that state, when you're about to smash through to the alien dimension, oh man, an hour is, yeah, I'm real proud of myself for not reaching for the trip killer. Like I almost did, but I just like, I thought, you know, I can do this. Like, what's the worst that can happen? I have a full-on breakthrough. Actually empowering, because it showed me that even if I'm fucking miserable, mid-trip, heightened, exaggerated feelings, I can breathe through it on my own. I'm grateful for that. See, you can flip all these things and extract some positives from them. But yeah, so it moved from that. And then it just kind of got worse for a while. It was like this delirium, like I said, experience where I was seeing different parts of my personality. And then things got like, they went into real delirium. See, I'd get up and then like, you know, go pee or something, drink a sip of water and then lay down. After I'd lay back down, it would feel like I was getting up and repeating, like I was in a loop, but I was aware that it was just in my mind. Like I actually had the wherewithal to separate that it was imagined, where in the past I'd have no way to separate whether my mind was creating the loop or whether I was actually just, you know, repeating myself, like actually getting up and doing the same thing over and over again, which is what you define as the loops. So it was interesting being in the loop state, but being aware that it was just my mind creating it. And it was far less scary that way. I feel like learning how to meditate allowed me to observe the loops from that retracted viewpoint. And what's interesting is this phase is also accompanied by a lot of chaotic thoughts. And by chaotic thoughts, I mean things you don't understand. It's so hard to explain because you can't make sense of it. It's like, imagine you're talking to a lamppost in your mind and like you're having sentences, but the sentences are made of bricks. Like it makes literally no sense. And I was going through some delirious states like that. Like, you know, talking to lampposts, baby. Fucking walking through Narnia. Foothills of snow. Meeting some minotaurs. Just really weird shit. And I was just really observing it. And it was really fascinating to take that retracted view where I wasn't just immersed in it. I was actually like observing kind of like from a distance. And that was also empowering because that showed me that I don't need to fall victim to my thoughts, you know, feel like I'm the prey of my own fearful mind, because there was a lot of fearful thoughts. Like when I was having the views of like the negative people in my lives, like it was injected with some serious paranoia where I was thinking about like just all kinds of bad shit that can happen to you. Like nightmare, horror story, bad shit. But in the past where I would be so terrified of this, again, I was kind of just like aware of the fear, but not attached to it. You know, it was really interesting. As someone who's like still dealing with like their kratom addiction, I figured I was still super mentally unhealthy, but clearly some of the stuff I've been doing has been working. Like maybe I think I'm so worse off, but I'm not. Like maybe I'm mentally so much, I think I am so much stronger than I realize. I don't give myself enough credit because I'm always like nitpicking and finding these like little things I'm still doing. Like in my head, I'm like, you're doing such a terrible thing. You need to be perfect. But like really, well, there are those few things that I'm doing that suck, that are honestly shitty. I'm not justifying them. My mind has grown in experience points, and I'm gotten so much stronger in many ways that I'm very grateful for. It feels like real progress. And I find like if you can be arrogant and you can think that you're strong and you can handle all this stuff, but it's like having a trip is the great equalizer because it abolishes the ego and it puts you in the state where you're like, you got to face your shit. So if you've been lying about your strength, oh, it's going to come. It's going to shine through real fast, baby. And a lot of people, I think, are afraid of tripping because, like, you know, there's multiple reasons. They're afraid of the unexpected. They're afraid of what they don't know. They don't know what could happen. And they read all these horror stories, and it's like they're just terrified that something real negative is going to happen and they won't be the same after. If you trust yourself, like, if you deeply trust who you are and your capability to, you know, work through adversity, then you would trust that, yeah, it might be scary, but I'm going to be okay. And I feel like it really shines a light on the people who still have some insecurities that they haven't dealt with. And I'm not calling anybody out here. I'm not pointing any fingers because I know for sure I have my own insecurities I need to get through. But it's like I have some friends who are terrified to trip. And some of them have tripped and they had some bad experiences and they're terrified to face it again. I feel like once you get blown off that horse, you got to get back on. Because I've been in that stage of being absolutely terrified to do it. And I'm grateful that I, you know, face those fears. And sometimes facing the fears isn't necessarily tripping again. That's the worst thing you can do. Like you want to sit back and, like, figure out what freaked you out. And I'm going to go off on a horrible tangent here that we're gonna cut this thread immediately because it's going to go way far off base. But, yeah, the psychedelics can really show you what your insecurities still are and where you've gotten stronger versus what you still need to work on. I moved from those, like, the fever dream. It's actually really negative. Like, honestly, most of this experience was bad. It was really just feeling positive in the beginning until I got hit with maybe the daily withdrawal that I'm not aware of consciously, but I was now. And then it was like everything just sucked. And then I went from that to just feeling really nauseous, tried to pee, tried to drink some water. Every time I got up, I was like, ugh. And then I was just like in this weird this state where it felt like whatever this guardian thing is was just showing me all of this shit. And it really felt like tough love. Like that whole experience, honestly, was tough love. So I'm down here smiling. I'm just extracting the positives from that, baby. There's also a part of you that's like happy that you made it through it and it's over. There's this empowering feeling, especially when you don't take the trip killer and you're like, oh, I pushed, that was horrible and I pushed through. It's like, by no means am I over here saying that that was a great experience. 85% of that sucked ass. It wasn't fun. There's no part of me that would be like, yeah, I want to do that again. That was fun. No, most of it sucked, but it was like, like I said, you get the trip you need, not the one you want. I needed that because it showed me my strength. It was empowering in its shittiness. I'm sure more of it's going to come to me, but this video has gone on long enough. Let's cut this short for now because I need to go make a tea. I feel dehydrated. Yeah, let's wrap this thing up. If you enjoyed this video, smash that like button. Let me know below what you thought of it if you want more videos like this. Again, massive thank you to Surfshark for sponsoring my crazy shenanigans. And if you haven't already, make sure you visit psychsubstance.shop and pick up the limited edition black and pink trip blanket. I will admit that I had that thing snuggled close the entire experience and I do not regret it. Anyway, till next time, guys. I love you all. And yeah, this was a ride and a half. I hope you guys enjoyed. You know, I hope you can learn something from this. And I hope I made it clear that that was fucking terrifying. And I'm happy it's over. And yeah, I'm definitely not promoting any kind of substance use with this. If anything, I'm showing you just how scary these experiences can be and just how like strong, how much mental fortitude you need to make it through them. I have cultivated the strength over years. But anyway, that's enough. More on this later. Take care, guys. I love you and cheers.